Welcome, everyone, to our hearing for the 2022 State Transportation Improvement Program, STIP, and the North hearing. We are excited that you are here, and we are looking forward to all of the input today. Thank you for attending the first of the two hearings required prior to adopting the 2022 State Transportation Improvement Program, STIP. The STIP is a five-year program of capital improvements adopted by the Commission biennially in even-numbered years. It is comprised of the Regional Transportation Improvement Programs, the RTIPs, prepared by regional agencies, and the Interregional Transportation Improvement Program, ITIP, prepared by Caltrans. State law requires that the Commission hold at least two hearings, one in the North and the other in the South, before adopting the new STIP. The purpose of these hearings, as specified in Government Code Section 14529G, is to reconcile any objections by any county or regional agency to the Caltrans program or Caltrans's objections to any regional program. The hearings also provide an opportunity for each regional agency and Caltrans to explain its proposals and the reason that the Commission should include the proposal in the STIP. Each commissioner has been sent an electronic copy of the hearing briefing book prepared by staff. This is not a staff recommendation of any kind. It is simply staff's compilation of the RTIPs and the ITIP presented in a single format. A compilation of this magnitude, prepared in a relatively short time, may include some errors or misinterpretations. Therefore, the compiled information remains subject to updating and correction before we prepare the STIP recommendations for the STIP. We invite anyone concerned to bring us changes and corrections as soon as possible. Because participation from the public is so important, I do want Douglas to present the instructions for public participation, and then Teresa will provide an overview on the development of the 2022 STIP. Douglas?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Participants, welcome to the hearing for the Northern hearing for the 2022 State Transportation Improvement Program. The agenda for this meeting is located on the website, catc.ca.gov. For our commissioners, there will be no voting on items on this. This is strictly a hearing, and the chair will do her best to call on each of you in turn if you would like to make comments. For our presenters, you will have the ability to unmute yourself as needed, and we ask that you use your camera as much as possible. Please remember to speak at a steady pace. We also hope that you will re-mute yourself once you're done so that there is no there's no noise or feedback during other presenters. For our meeting attendees, we welcome comments from the public as part of each of the presentations at this hearing. We encourage you to use the raised hand feature as early into each presentation as you can to give the system time to acknowledge you. There are two options for you to be able to provide comments. You should see the webinar control panel, likely located on the right-hand side of your screen. There you will find the raise hand feature and the questions tab. Click on the hand icon to indicate you wish to make a comment. You will then be unmuted and called upon to make your comment. Please be sure to state your name and any affiliation prior to voicing your remarks. Alternately, you may use the questions tab. Please type in the area of you are making your comment on, and type in your comment, and commission staff will read the comment aloud for you. Please do your best to be concise, and please also make sure your comments add new information. Please also remember to speak at a steady pace so that everyone can clearly understand what you're trying to say. As a reminder, each attendee is provided with a unique link to access this webinar. These should not be shared as it can create confusion for staff when you're trying to make comments. Thank you for your time today.
Thank you so much, Douglas. And I will make sure that we take a break between each presenter so that there can be time for public comment based on each presenter's comments and presentations. With that, Teresa, thank you very much for introducing this and presenting an overview of the 2022 State Transportation Improvement Development.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The development of the 2022 The 22 STIP began with the adoption of the 22 STIP guidelines and the fund estimate on August 2021. The guidelines set the policy, standards, criteria, and procedures for the development and management of the STIP. The fund estimate sets the funding that is reasonably expected to be available over the STIP period. Per statute, the STIP must be constrained by the levels of the fund of the funding identified in the fund estimate. Each STIP covers a five-year period. The 22 STIP will cover fiscal years 22-23 to 26-27. The first 3 years of the STIP overlap with the 22 STIP, and the last 2 years are programming capacity that is added in the new STIP cycle. In addition, each STIP covers portions of consecutive four-year county share periods. For the 22 STIP, the first 2 years complete a four-year county share period, and the last 2 years start a new share period. The 22 fund estimate identified two targets for each region and Caltrans. These are total target and a maximum. Normally, a minimum target is also identified. However, with the 22 STIP fund estimate, it did not include a minimum target due to the limited programming capacity in the first 2 years of the STIP. The total target is the formula share distribution for the entire five-year STIP cycle. This is not a minimum, guaranteed, or limit on a project nomination or project selection. The maximum is the formula distribution based on an estimate of new capacity through the next county share period ending in 27-28. In order for a region to program projects up to their maximum, other regions must program less to their total target. The 22 STIP fund estimate identified $796 million in capacity for new STIP programming. Most of the capacity is in the last 2 years of the STIP, the last 2 years that are added to the STIP. We received the RTIPs and the ITIP by the deadline of December 15, 2021. Four RTPAs, Regional Transportation Planning Agencies, elected not to submit an RTIP, mainly because they were not proposing any new programming. These were Alpine, MODOC, San Benito, and Tahoe. We prepared a hearing book that is a compilation of the RTIPs and the ITIP presented in the single format. This is the hearing book Chair Norton was referring to that we emailed to each one of you. At the front of the hearing book is the summary that compares the RTIPs and the ITIP proposals against the program capacity levels identified in the fund estimate. In total, the proposed amount for the RTIPs and the ITIP is $760 million, right below our capacity identified in the fund estimate. The programming challenge in this STIP is that proposals for the first 3 years of the STIP period exceed the capacity available by approximately $350 million. This means that many projects proposed for the first 3 years will not be, will have to be moved to the last 2 years of the STIP. In total, there were 32 counties and Caltrans that proposed or below their target. Similarly, there were 24 counties that proposed above their total target, including 9 counties that have advances and have no target. They only proposed a PPM. Although total proposals are below the available capacity, staff may not recommend programming every project as some proposals may not be consistent with STIP guidelines. After the STIP hearings, staff will begin preparing a comprehensive recommendation for adoption of the 22 STIPs scheduled for the March Commission meeting. As required by statute, staff will publish its recommendation no later than 20 days in advance of the STIP adoption. This is scheduled for February 28th. Staff recommendation will be based on the proposals in the RTIPs and the ITIP, the capacity identified in the fund estimate, policies and procedures for STIP guidelines, and any further information we receive during and following these hearings. We will continue working with Caltrans and the regions to address any questions or unresolved issues as we develop our staff recommendations and to make sure we understand regional and interregional priorities and that no one is surprised by what we recommend or why we're recommending it. After this introduction, we will move into the interregional and regional presentations. Caltrans will make a presentation of its ITIP, and each regional agency will have an opportunity to comment on their RTIP, as well as the ITIP. Before Caltrans in each region, staff will give a brief overview of the proposal, including any specific issues to that proposal. That concludes my remarks. If there are any questions, we can begin the presentations.
Commissioners, do you have any questions or any comments you'd like to make before Teresa moves on to the presentations? If not, thank you very much, Teresa, and we will look forward to hearing from Caltrans on their presentation.
Yes. So the first one I will introduce is the Interregional Transportation Improvement Program. This you will find in your hearing book on pages 87 and 89. The fund estimate identified available new capacity for the interregional program at $178 million. This is approximately 25% of the STIP capacity. Per statute, interregional program is further subdivided, 60% going outside the urbanized areas on an interregional road system, with a minimum of 15% for interregional rail projects. 40% can go anywhere in the state subject to the 60-40 split. Caltrans is proposing to program $106 million to new projects and $66 million to add phases to existing projects. This results in a total of $172 million of new programming, which is $6 million below their total target of $178 million. Some of the issues staff has concerning the ITIP proposal is the following. The ITIP proposal is not very clear on the statutory programming limits that they've identified. As I stated earlier, the 60-40 and 60%, 40%, 60-40 split. It is not very clear whether the ITIP is meeting those statutory programming limits. In addition, as I indicated earlier, there is no programming capacity in the early years. Caltrans is proposing $135 million of new funding in the first 3 years. It is unclear if the new rail projects proposed for funding are federal trust fund or state highway account eligible. Since there is no public transportation account, we need to make sure those all rail projects are federally and state highway account eligible, and we are unclear whether they are or not. In addition, these rail projects are missing many of the performance measures information that we require as required by STIP guidelines. A couple of the new rail projects do not have full funding commitments, meaning they are not fully funded unless they are seeking SB1 funding in the upcoming cycles. Staff will not be able to recommend approval. There are two active transportation projects that are proposed to be solely funded with interregional funds. This is the first since the STIP had a dedicated fund source of active transportation, a federal program known as the Transportation Enhancement Program. This program ended in 2012. We strongly support Caltrans's effort to fund more active transportation projects. However, it does appear that these projects are more suited for the SHOP program. Further, we have asked the department how these two projects were selected as their highest active transportation priorities in the state. In addition, the proposal of these active transportation projects are not very clear on the interregional benefits this projects will provide. It appears that the benefit is, it will greatly benefit a local community. And we wonder as to why Caltrans did not partner with the local agencies to fund these projects. We recognize the acceptance of these type of projects, and we will continue to work with the department to determine how best to fund these projects. Overall, for all new projects, the scope of work should be well defined. It needs to be clear what work the interregional funds will be used for. While identifying benefits like moving X amount of people on rail is important, we need to know the actual infrastructure improvements that are being proposed. Madam Chair, that concludes my issues, my remarks on the ITIP. James Anderson, the Division Chief for the Division of Financial Programming, is here to provide an overview of the ITIP proposal.
Thank you very much, Teresa, and we're looking forward to your presentation, Mr. Anderson.
Thank you, Teresa. Good morning, Chair Norton, commissioners, transportation partners, and all others in attendance. As Teresa indicated, my name is James Anderson, and I'm the Division Chief of National Programming with Caltrans. I have the pleasure of presenting the final 2022 Interregional Transportation Improvement Program, also referred to as the ITIP. Since we have already shared project level details for the proposed 2022 ITIP at the ITIP hearings, the plan is to keep this presentation at a very high level, and we plan to yield most of our time to the regions. Next slide, please. One of the goals of the 2022 ITIP is to ensure consistency and alignment across statewide plans, policies, including the goals in the California Transportation Plan 2050, the Climate Action Plan for Transportation Infrastructure, referred to as CAPTI, CAPTI's vision and guiding principles, and the Interregional Transportation Strategic Plan, also referred to as the ITSP. The objectives in the ITSP are focused on interregional travel. The ITSP provides the framework to guide the investment of ITIP funds, including strategic improvements for the entire interregional system. The 2021 ITSP includes a greater emphasis on climate change, equity, and accessibility. The proposed projects for the 2022 ITIP were added because they are consistent with CAPTI and the 2021 ITSP. Next slide, please. With limited funding available for this ITIP cycle, projects were prioritized based on the following: cost increases for currently programmed projects, currently programmed ITIP projects that need funding to complete remaining phases, project cost and our ITIP request amount for the based on the limited funding available in the 2022 ITIP, the scoring criteria for the ITIP projects, the scoring criteria that was based on the ITSP. I just want to make that to reference for people that are new or may not have made that connection.
Very helpful. Thank you.
Yes, and prioritizing new projects consistent with the ITSP and CAPTI. I did want to point out that some of the active transportation projects that we're proposing for this ITIP, Caltrans considered three crucial data points. And those data points were the ITSP scoring criteria. We considered input from stakeholders. And last but not least, these projects that they were ready to go, and they were consistent with CAPTI and the ITSP. Next slide, please. So the 2022 STIP fund estimate provided $178.2 million in new capacity. There was a mid-cycle adjustment due to COVID relief funds, added an additional $16.8 million in new capacity. So the ITIP had a total capacity of $195 million for this STIP cycle. Next slide, please. So the $195 million in available new capacity was used to fund the carryover projects, including cost changes, and that resulted in about $79 million. And the new projects for almost $109 million, I think it was $108 million, $108.7 million, very close to $109 million. Next slide, please. So in summary, for the 2022 ITIP, Caltrans is proposing 11 new projects, Of those 11 new projects, we're proposing 2 active transportation projects, 1 new highway project, and 8 passenger rail projects. These projects reflect the priorities described in the 2021 ITSP that was just recently adopted and will help us implement CAPTI and work towards our climate, health, and equity goals by increasing state transportation options for the traveling public. With the programming of these projects, these 11 projects, it should be pointed out that over half of the 2022 ITIP investments will be for rail, transit, and active transportation infrastructure. Next slide, please. So previously, in November 2021, ITIP hearings were conducted and the feedback was generally very positive. All of the comments, emails, and letters received and responded to are included in the proposed final 2022 ITIP for your review and reference. Next slide, please. With regard to the input or feedback, Caltrans appreciates all the comments, questions, and suggestions. The important takeaway from this slide is that all comments, emails, and letters were responded to and are included in the proposed final ITIP. Again, Caltrans takes your comments very seriously and suggestions and questions. And while there's always room for improvement, we do our best to be sure that we're meeting expectations and we try to exceed them to the extent possible. Next slide, please. This concludes the final 2022 ITIP presentation, and I'm happy to speak to any questions that you may have.
Great. Thank you so much. We have no public comment right now on this presentation. Commissioners or Mitch, do you have any comments on this Caltrans presentation as given?
Yeah, I just want to reiterate some of the things that Teresa mentioned. You know, there's a required statutory breakdown that the ITIP hasn't met. We have questions on project scope. We have questions on funding eligibility and their performance measurement requirements. For us to recommend projects, these issues all need to be resolved. I just wanted to be clear about that.
Executive Director Weiss, thank you for your comments, and we will work with commission staff to clarify and answer all these questions.
Fantastic. And then what is the venue that those answers will be presented, both Mitch and James? And Teresa.
So normally, okay, so the way it works after the hearings, we will continue working with the agencies and the department to resolve any issues prior to our staff recommendations. Okay, so all the issues that I brought forward, I will be working with them specifically on each and every project and determine whether or not staff can make a recommendation on the projects.
Wonderful. I always want to make clear all of these things because we got feedback from our equity roundtable that we want to continue to be very transparent and clear about what process looks like and when our feedback is going to come back to the public.
Right. And you know, just to be clear also, these issues that I've laid out, they're not new to the department. James, I make sure that James and his staff knew what the concerns we've had. So, and we've been working on them slowly, and we're still working with them.
Absolutely. Wonderful. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Teresa, now that we've had the presentation from Caltrans, are you going to sort of MC the presentations from all of the, thank you.
Yes, so Casey will be giving an overview of each of the regions, and then we have the list of presenters that I will be able to unmute and hopefully turn on their camera so they can provide us an overview of their art tips, okay? So
wonderful.
Casey, do you wanna take it away?
Yep, I'll take over. So the first regional presenter will be the Metropolitan Transportation Commission, also known as MTC. I'll go ahead and provide a quick overview of the RTIP that they provided, and then I'll introduce the speakers. So MTC covers the 9 counties of the San Francisco Bay Area. You can find the individual counties listed on the following pages in the hearing book. Alameda, pages 2 and 3. Contra Costa, pages 10 and 11, Marin, page 30, Napa, pages 39 and 40, San Francisco, pages 55 and 56, San Mateo, pages 60 and 61, Santa Clara, pages 64 and 65, Solano, pages 73 and 74, and finally, Sonoma, page 75 and 76. The law permits MTC to pool its county shares for a STIP period by adopting a resolution and submitting it with its RTIP, provided that the amount of any county share advanced or reserved is not more than 15% of the county share. This means that, just like the rest of the state, every county is guaranteed its share in the long run, but there is a little more flexibility between counties in the MTC area than in the rest of the state. The MTC resolution allows the pooling of county shares conditional on the 85% to 115% adjustment rule. For its 9-county area, the MTC has proposed a total of $141.668 million, or $10.2 million under its target of $151,868,000. That includes $124.629 million for highways and $17,039,000 for transit. For highways, the RTIP includes $124.2 million with most of the new programming, $117.2 million proposed in years 2 and 3, while the capacity for new programming is in years 4 and 5, which is years fiscal years 25, 26, and 26, 27 of the STIP. Also, the RTIP does not specify project priorities across counties. As we have noted, every dollar we program over target in one area means we must program under target in another. For transit, there are two new projects, one BART project proposed in Contra Costa in fiscal year 22-23, and one Muni project in San Francisco proposed in fiscal year 25-26 for $10.6 million. Both are federally eligible. Major projects include $11.9 million for the Route 880 Oakland-Alameda access in Alameda County, $25 million for Innovate 680 Coordinated Adaptive Ramp metering in Contra Costa County, $15 million for Route 680 Northbound Express Lane completion phase one in Contra Costa County, and $10.642 million for the communications-based train control phase three, which is a North Judah route in San Francisco County. That concludes my remarks, and I am going to introduce Teresa Rommel, Director, and Kenneth Cow, Assistant Director from the Metropolitan Transportation Commission.
Thank you, Casey, and good morning, Chair Norton and fellow commissioners, or other fellow commissioners. I'm Kenneth Cow with Metropolitan Transportation's Funding Policy and Program section. And before I begin, I did want to also make a quick shout out to Commissioner Bob Alvarado, who I know is retiring soon. And I know that you also received a resolution of appreciation from our commission yesterday. So again, wanted to thank you and to recognize you and all your years of service to the commission and the state. So thank you very much. I would like to, first, thank you for the opportunity for MTC to provide the presentation on the Bay Area's proposed RTIP. I would like to introduce Teresa Rommel, the director of MTC's funding policies and program section, who will provide the Bay Area's RTIP presentation. After the presentation, Carl Anderson on MTC's state programming team and I will join Teresa to help answer any questions. So now I'll turn it over to Teresa.
Thanks, Kenny. Can everyone hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you very clearly. Thank you.
All right, thanks. Thanks a lot, Kenny. And good morning. I think it's still morning, commissioners. As Kenny noted, I'm the Director of Funding Policy and Programs at the Metropolitan Transportation Commission, and I'm really pleased to be here today, the first time virtually, to give an overview of the 2022 Bay Area Regional Transportation Improvement Program. The RTIP is an important source of transportation funding in the Bay Area, and it helps us advance the goals of Plan Bay Area 2050, which is MTC's Regional Transportation Plan and Sustainable Community Strategy, which was just adopted in October of 2021. Investments made through the RTIP will contribute towards Plan Bay Area 2050 goals to advance equity, maintain and optimize the existing transportation system, create healthy and safe streets, and build a next generation transit network. And we can go to the next slide, please. So the MTC region received $152 million in new transportation funding capacity. And the proposed Bay Area 2022 RTIP includes $141 million in new programming requests. The MTC region proposes programming the new RTIP capacity to important projects throughout the Bay Area focused on the state highway system, supporting proposed SB1 competitive program nominations, and maintaining aging transit assets in a state of good repair. The region also requests advancing future RTIP shares in Santa Clara and Contra Costa counties. Of the requested $141 million, 30% will improve and reconstruct state highways, 34% will construct and convert HOV lanes to express lanes, and 24% will upgrade and reconstruct important regional transit assets. The remaining RTIP funding will benefit local roads, bicycle and pedestrian projects, future incentive programs, and planning efforts. MTC developed the 2022 RTIP in partnership with the Bay Area County Transportation Agencies and adopted the final RTIP program of projects on December 15, 2021. Prior to adoption, MTC presented the program of projects and regional policies and procedures to various regional working groups and committees and released the final draft RTIP on project list for public comment and review on December 1st, 2021. You go to the next slide, please. So I would like to highlight a few projects and how they help implement the strategies of Plan Bay Area 2050, particularly the orange puzzle piece shown on the slide there. To advance building a next generation transit network, the 2022 RTIP includes projects such as those proposed by San Francisco and BART. In San Francisco, SFMTA proposes $10 million for the third phase of their communications-based train control system throughout the city. The improvements in San Francisco will increase system reliability, allowing for better connections to communities around the city. BART proposes $6 million for station modernization projects in Alameda and Contra Costa counties. A critical element of these improvements is to improve station access for users, increasing the overall system benefits to riders. The 2022 RTIP includes about $16 million in new programming that constructs and improves regional transit assets. I'd also like to highlight a few projects that identified RTIP funds as a match for potential SB1 nominations. MTC's RTIP policies strongly encourage counties to program RTIP funds to leverage SB1 competitive funding. Counties programmed RTIP funds for this upcoming round for three proposed SB1 nominations. The first in Alameda County is the Oakland-Alameda Access Project, which will significantly improve access along I-880 and in and around the Webster and Posey tubes, connecting downtown Oakland and the city of Alameda. In Santa Clara County, the US 101 Express Lanes Phase 5 project will construct and convert existing lanes to express lanes along 101 in both directions from Sunnyvale to I-880 in San Jose. VTA is also considering multimodal elements to enhance the project benefits further. The extended managed and tolled lanes on US 101 further south into Santa Clara County builds upon prior state investments on the US 101 corridor. Earlier segments through San Mateo County and northern Santa Clara County were funded by SB1 Solutions for Congested Corridors Program Cycle 1. And in Contra Costa County, CCTA proposes RTIP funding for pre-construction phases to get their project shovel ready for subsequent SB1 competitive cycles. The Innovate 680 Coordinated Adaptive Ramp Metering project and I-680 Northbound Express Lane Completion Phase 1 project are a part of a suite of projects called Innovate 680, which aims to provide a new set of easy-to-use options and tools that will improve mobility. All of the proposed highway projects are consistent with MTC's RTP strategy to maintain and optimize the existing system by improving interchanges and roadways to address bottlenecks. And finally, I'd like to highlight bicycle and pedestrian projects that create healthy and safe streets. In Sonoma County, the US 101 Bicycle and Pedestrian Overcrossing Project in Santa Rosa will provide a Class 1 ADA accessible and mode separated bicycle and pedestrian overcrossing over US Highway 101, including a new crosswalk, curb ramps, pedestrian lighting, and ADA compliant ramps. Also in Sonoma County, the West County Trail Gap Closure Project will complete two Class 1 bike path segments in the unincorporated area of West Sonoma County in Grayton and near Sebastopol. The completed projects will close a 0.20 mile and 0.90 mile gap, respectively. Both projects will help create healthy and safe streets and advance Plan BEAR 2050 goals to reduce VMT, increase the share of bike and pedestrian trips, and meet our CARB mandated GHG target. You can move to the next slide, which is just a kind of a map of proposed projects. Next slide. Here we go. Just a proposed map of proposed projects. MTC has many ambitious outcomes and strategies in Plan Bay Area 2050. MTC and our partners are excited about the opportunities afforded by the STIP and other SB1 programs, and we look forward to putting the funds to good use for the public's benefit as soon as possible. You can go to the last slide, please. So in conclusion, thank you for considering our RTP. The Bay Area appreciates the hard work you and your staff and Caltrans staff have dedicated to our RTIP proposal. And we look forward to working together as the CTC considers the 2022 STIP adoption in March. And my team and I would be glad to answer any questions you might have about our RTIP. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. And I'm so delighted to hear that you honored Vice Chair Alvarado in that way at your last meeting. That's wonderful. We have no public comments on this portion of the presentation, but I'm sure we have some input from our commissioners. So I'm going to give them a chance to get the screens up. And I see Vice Chair-elect Carl Gardino.
Chair Norton, thank you. Kenneth and Teresa, thank you for the presentation this morning. Kenneth, thanks for your communications before each of our meetings. Those are always quite helpful to us who reside in the Bay Area and therefore perhaps know it a little better, but it is just a great assistance to our mutual efforts to improve our region and our state. I have a few items that I'd love to discuss with you both to save the commission time today. However, perhaps we can schedule time for next week or the week after. Great. So, Chair Norton, I'll take it offline with Teresa and Kenneth. Kenneth, at your convenience, if you can send me an email, we'll line that up. And thank you both for the very clear presentation.
Commissioner, before you get off this screen, I would like to hear, as a Bay Area resident, the things that you're most excited about in the presentation that you're hearing right now.
Oh, the ongoing emphasis on transit options for our residents and connectability of our systems for the benefit of 9 counties and nearly 8 million people in the region. So good job in pulling together 9 counties, 101 cities now, Kenneth?
Yep.
Yeah, and doing the best that we can to connect systems and people and communities together.
Well said. Thank you so much. Are there other commissioners who wish to speak on the MTC presentation?
Madam Chair, I have a comment real quickly. As Casey pointed out, the biggest challenge with the MTC, their great projects, is the programming years. You know, so the programming years were over programmed. So unless you are able to delay projects, that's going to be our biggest challenge, to be able to accommodate $117 million in the first 3 years of the STIP. Just, I probably will continue saying that throughout the hearing. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Seeing no other comments from my colleagues on the MTC presentation, I want to thank you, Kenneth and Teresa, for your great presentation. And Teresa, Fabula, if you could introduce the TAMC presentation.
I'll go ahead and present them. Thank you, Teresa and Kenny. So moving on to the Transportation Agency for Monterey, also known as TAMC. Monterey County is available on page 38 of the hearing book. Monterey proposes to program $8.7 million to existing projects, which is just below their target. Proposals include an additional $7 million to the Route 68 operational improvements from Joslyn Canyon Road to San Venancio Road project, adding $2.1 million to environmental and shifting $12 million from right-of-way to the PSNE phase, funding design at $23.5 million. They are also adding $1.9 million to environmental of the Route 101 South County Freeway conversion project. That concludes my remarks. Todd Muck is available, and you may go ahead and begin. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Mr. Muck. Thank you, Casey.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair Norton and members of the CTC Commission. My name is Todd Muck, and I'm the Executive Director at TAMC. Monterey County's Regional Transportation Improvement Program reflects the connected nature of transportation in Monterey County. Our county is big and diverse, over 3,700 square miles from the Monterey Peninsula on the coast to Salinas Valley agricultural fields inland. And we need a connected system to meet the diverse transportation needs of our disadvantaged populations, commuters, agriculture, freight, and tourists. Our focus is on making our transportation safer for all users, delivering high priority bus, highway, rail, and bike and pedestrian projects throughout the region, constructing projects that are innovative and equitable, and doing all this in a way that helps the state meet ambitious state climate action goals. Since the 2022 RTIP, TAMC has been planning, funding, and building our multimodal program of projects. The first phase of Monterey County's rail extension project has completed construction, providing a multimodal transportation hub in Salinas, anticipating expanding rail service from Silicon Valley down to Salinas. The Marina to Salinas multimodal corridor will be breaking ground this summer. The project is a true local, true state and local agency partnership, is funded with STIP, LPP competitive funds, local Measure X sales tax, and local developer fees. The project delivers a new corridor of roundabouts with bicycle and pedestrian and transit improvements through a heavily congested commute route. Our next project that will be ready for construction is the State Route 156 Castro Boulevard interchange. The current 156 Castro Boulevard intersection is the top collision location in Monterey County. The SR 156 is a major link connecting the Bay Area to Monterey Peninsula. This project is funded with STIP, Trade Corridor Enhancement Program, and local Measure X funds. The project includes bicycle and pedestrian improvements that will improve access to nearby high school and local circulation improvements that will benefit access to adjacent low-income and affordable housing. While TAMC is delivering on these projects, we're hard at work getting the next set of projects ready for construction. Our priority projects included in the 2022 RTIP include the second construction package for the Monterey County Rail Extension, Silicon Valley to Salinas. This will be ready for construction in 2022-2023. The 68 Scenic Route Monterey to Salinas corridor, we're looking to complete the environmental and design phases during this SIP cycle. This is a major commute corridor that connects the employment centers in Salinas and the Monterey Peninsula. And we're proposing to build a series of roundabouts replacing existing intersections to provide a safe and innovative corridor that also improves wildlife crossings. And finally, I'd like to highlight the US 101 South of Salinas project. And we'll be looking to complete the environmental phase for this project as well in this STIP cycle. This is a significant commute corridor and also an important interregional corridor for goods movement to get Monterey County's agricultural products to market. The project's critical safety improvements include separating freight traffic with frontage roads, closing unsafe at-grade turning lanes, and upgrading intersections. In conclusion, I would really like to express TAMC's partnership with the CTC and Caltrans has been integral in delivering projects that we look forward to continuing this partnership with the 2022 RTIP and SB1 programs. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We have no public comment on this particular presentation. Commissioners, did you have any comments that you wanted to make or questions you wanted to ask of Mr. Muck? Well, thank you. That was a very thorough presentation. I guess we have all the information we need, and we're very much looking forward to discussing these projects with you as we move forward in the process.
Thank you, Chair.
Appreciate your time. Yes. We are going to move up the Fresno COG presentation because we have an elected official that would like to join us for this presentation. So, Casey, would you like to introduce the Fresno COG?
Absolutely. So, Fresno COG is available on page 14 of the STIP hearing book that was distributed. Fresno is proposing to program $10.8 million, which is under their target of $22.4 million. The proposal adds the construction phase to the Excelsior Expressway project with 10 million of Fresno shares. They are partnering with Caltrans to fund the phase. Proposals include adding construction of 10 million to an existing project. And Mr. Phipps, you're welcome to begin.
Thank you, and thank you, Chairwoman Norton. The Fresno region has a long-standing policy of leveraging our valued state and federal funding on major improvements by partnering with our local sales tax measure C. And as in previous STIP cycles, our RTIP reflects the strong partnership among Fresno COG, the Fresno County Transportation Authority, Caltrans, and the CTC that enables the region to maximize our project delivery. That partnership was never better demonstrated than when we collaborated with Caltrans and FCTA to identify a funding plan to complete our State Route 41 Excelsior Expressway project. Fresno COG is proposing $10 million in the RTIP, while FCTA is contributing $13 million from our local sales tax, and Caltrans is proposing the remaining $23 million in its 2022 ITIP. As a major safety improvement project carrying our residents to and from the Central Coast, the State Route 41 Excelsior Expressway project has been seeking completion now for decades, and is going to come as a major relief to the many residents who travel routinely and to those who have lost loved ones on this route. Fresno COG's original self-help measure expanded State Route 41 to Elkhorn Avenue, 6 miles from the Kings County line. Kings County picked up the job, improving the route to Lemoore, but leaving an unimproved gap on the remaining segment in Fresno. So over the last decade, that 6 mile gap has recorded 146 collisions and 19 fatalities, accounting for 35% of the deaths on the entire 44-mile stretch of State Route 41 in Fresno County. Aside from the safety improvements, this project will also increase connectivity for our economically underserved and tribal communities, improve operational efficiency for interregional freight movement and local farm-to-market travel, provide access to essential services for many of our rural residents, and help relieve congestion. Now, we're also carrying over our South Fresno Interchange project that will modify two interchanges along State Route 99 at America and North Central, Cedar Avenues. Our RTIP this year proposes the 2021 mid-cycle STIP funding of $4.7 million to the American Avenue segment for design and right-of-way to ensure that this project remains on track for construction. Both interchanges are being developed concurrently, and construction is programmed in fiscal year 23-24. The projects programmed in our 2022 RTIP provide regional and statewide benefits that will contribute to an efficient, safe, integrated, and sustainable transportation system. Program projects will improve safety along two of our major corridors, State Route 99, State Route 41, both of which are identified as priority interregional facilities in the Interregional Transportation Strategic Plan, and will help accomplish the ITSP's goals, as well as those that are adopted in our RTP SCS. So in closing, Fresno COG, thanks you, Madam Chairwoman, the Commission, Caltrans, and the rest of our partners for their contribution in this RTIP process. We look forward to contributing to our partnerships and continuing to deliver great transportation projects. And so thank you again for your consideration of our RTIP. Respectfully, as mentioned, I would like to yield the remainder of my time to Assemblymember Jim Patterson and also Fresno County Transportation Authority Executive Director Mike Leonardo.
Thank you very much. Welcome, Assemblymember Patterson.
Thank you. Appreciate being with you. First of all, I want to express how much we appreciate the fact that the funding to finish this 6-mile stretch of Highway 41 in Fresno County is in the draft. The ITIP, it is a dangerous 6-mile stretch, as has been identified. I also want to reiterate how much this is a community-driven effort to complete a section of Highway 41 that has been left unfinished and obviously dangerous for a long, long time. A lot of people in the region, a lot of people who drive or live near that section, and the institutions that have been mentioned that work together to fund our transportation, all have come together, and we appreciate Caltrans' interest and support in this as well. As was reminded earlier, that the state data shows that this stretch of highway was responsible for 30% of all the fatalities on Highway 41 in Fresno County in the last decade. We really do appreciate that this project is being in the ITIP draft, and we are looking forward to it being formally approved so that we can get underway in fixing this long neglected stretch of highway that has really created some dangerous circumstances. And yes, Thank you everybody for your hands-on help in this. We appreciate it greatly. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I believe Director Mike Leonardo is going to speak next.
Okay, there we go. So I'm muted now. Thank you. Hopefully my camera is working. I'm not sure if it is, but I don't want to take a lot of time to do that. So really, everything has been said. I don't want to reiterate things that you've already heard. I want to emphasize our appreciation to Caltrans for putting this in the ITIP, to Fresno COG for putting it in the RTIP, and to the FCTA board for actually amending this into their expenditure plan so that they could provide the last bit of funding. So this is a 50-50 partnership between the ITIP and the locals through the RTIP and Measure C. It's one in a long, we've been partnering with Caltrans, the COG, and the CTC for over 35 years to improve transportation in Fresno County. And this is just one more example of that great partnership that we've had. So I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you and look forward to adoption of the full STIP. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We are very excited to have our incoming chair-elect, Commissioner Eager, to speak on these issues. And I did want to recognize that we have no public comment at this time. Commissioner Eager?
Yes, thank you, Chair Norton. And I know we have been discussing these issues for a long time. This is a perfect example of a project that I think Commissioner Liu talked about yesterday, is when we're looking at some of those that are called expansion projects, that we make sure that those projects are the ones that are essential, that really focus on safety issues. This is one of those. You know, sometimes people say, well, gosh, you know, could we use our money elsewhere in putting things in areas where, you know, people could get on their bikes or find different ways to get from point A to point B. You know, yesterday we talked about 46, or maybe today. Today we're talking about 41. When you live in Kern County or Fresno County or Kings County, the only road to get from those Central Valley areas to the other part of the state, to San Luis Obispo County, to the coast, is along those roads. And I'm one to tell you, I wish there were other ways to get there. I wish there was public transportation. I wish there was any other way to get there but to drive on those roads, but there's not. And so By adding these lanes, it's not going to add any new people on the roads. Those same people drive from those areas, the people in Fresno that work at Lemoore Naval Air Station. That's their only way to get to work. And so this really is a very important safety project that I'm proud to be part of the commission that is going to be moving that forward. So as we look across the state, really looking at those issues that Commissioner Liu talked about, essential projects that look at safety issues, I'm all for it, and this is one of them. So thank you.
Well said, Commissioner Eager. Thank you so much. Commissioners, are there other comments you'd like to make on this particular presentation from Fresno COG?
It is a very important project, and you know what? I do want to command all the regional agency to partner on this project because this is what's all about to the safety concerns. With that said, though, it is programming the third year of the STIP, which is we're over programmed. So we're going to be working with Caltrans as well as the regional agencies to how we can use all the tools that we have, like AB 3090, or to be able to keep this project on schedule on that fiscal year. That's all I wanted to bring in.
Thank you so much. With that, Casey, could you introduce the STANCOG?
Absolutely. So STANCOG is the Stanislaus County of Governments, and they are available on page 77 of the hearing book. Stanislaus proposes to delete 0.5 million programmed with regular shares for right-of-way on the Route 132 four-lane expressway phase two project and advanced right-of-way with 2.3 million in COVID shares. Stanislaus also proposes to program 8 million of their $8.4 million target to add construction for the Route 132 project. The project will also seek SB1 funds to fund construction. Available to speak is Rosa de Leon Park, the executive director of STANCOG. Rosa, are you available? Also available is Vito Chisa, board member.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Good afternoon, commissioners. My name is Rosa de Leon Park, and I am the executive director for the Stanislaus Council of Governments.
Oh, wonderful. We see you now.
Great. I hope you can hear me okay.
Somehow we can. Now we can't. You're muted.
Okay. Can you hear me? Perfect.
We can.
Thank you. So I apologize. We want to speak about our state Route 132 West project. It is Stanislaus Council of Governments' top priority regional transportation project. Phase one is currently under construction at a cost of $150 million, including $46 million from STANCOG's Measure L program and $100 million in Senate Bill 1 and federal funding. Phase one is scheduled to be completed later in this year of 2022. Phase two will expand the two-lane facility on the new alignment built in phase one by constructing a four-lane freeway from State Route 99 to North Dakota Avenue in the city of Modesto. This project has countywide support, including Modesto residents, their city council, the trucking, farming industries, our elected state representatives, and Congressman Josh Harder. Environmental studies for phase two are complete and design is underway using $10 million in Measure L and RIP funding. STANCOG is here today requesting that the CTC support the programming of $10.7 million in RIP funding for the right-of-way and construction of phase two project. Stancock will be pursuing Senate Bill 1 and federal grants to fully fund construction. With your support, we anticipate the same success in delivering phase two that we achieved with phase one. I would like to now introduce our policy board member here at the Stanislaus Council of Government, member Vito Chiesa. Can you guys still hear us?
Yes, we can.
Can you hear us?
Yes, we can.
Casey, can you hear us? Again, okay, we had this terrible echo. Hopefully you didn't have the same thing. So my name is Vito Chiesa. Good morning, Chair and fellow commissioners. I appreciate you taking the time just to allow us to talk about our project. Rosa gave you a quick overview of the project. I'd like to give you some quick context for Stanislaus County. Over the last few years, we passed a self-help. We became a part of the self-help coalition. We passed a half cent sales tax back in 2016, which has really changed the way we're doing business. Obviously, after two failures, we've done transit consolidation since in the time that I've been on the board. We've gone from five transit operators down to two, and one of those operators is now covering about 87% of the county's population, and we're seeing better service already through that. We're also the ACE extension is coming down to Modesto and Ceres. It's expected to be here next year. And so we're embracing the rail, the state rail plan. I'm also a member of the San Joaquin Joint Powers Authority, which operates the Amtrak, San Joaquin Amtrak system. So we're trying to get hourly service down to Stanislaus County between the two services through the state rail plan, and then integrating into the high-speed rail stop into Merced. So we're doing lots of things that I think are important. Also, I saw Rob Phipps was talking, but Fresno is leading the Regional Policy Council on a potential inland port, so we can take some of the trucks off of the road. I want you to understand that Stanislaus County is still an ag-based economy. The San Joaquin Valley is too. Eight of our 10 largest major manufacturing employers are ag-based, and you know the names. There's Gallo and Foster Farms and Blue Diamond and ConAgra and Del Monte. So we have to get those things to the port. We have to get those things to market. So roadways are still an important component, although we're taking every opportunity to get them on some sort of multimodal, I'm sorry. Something I want to talk about, 132 specifically. Right now, currently, there's about 8.2 million tons of product that is being moved on that. The road actually goes right through the middle of Modesto. So the phase one is to go around so that we can do clean up our air quality, we can keep vehicles moving, but safety is truly the number one concern. The corridor has a 50% higher fatality rate and 24% higher fatality injury accident rate than the statewide average for similar facilities. It's a very dangerous corridor for us. It's been continuously ranked as one of the state's most dangerous corridors between 2013 and 2017. There were 121 accidents and four fatalities reported in the project corridor. That's just a component of it. And again, I sit on the San Joaquin Valley Air Pollution Control Board, and I don't have to tell anyone about our challenges in the valley. So we're looking at every opportunity we can, keeping vehicles moving. Obviously, not stopping and starting in Modesto will be helpful for that. I just want to thank the board again. I think that, you know, there's always been a push towards doing things better. And Stanislaus County, I think we've embraced that completely. It doesn't, speaking to Commissioner Eager's comments about the east-west corridors, you know, we've got north south quarters in 99 and I-5, but it's still important to get things across the valley. And 132 is the most important one in Stanislaus County from a safety opportunity. I made a promise to the voters when we passed Measure L. We have 16 regional projects. If you want to see me speaking before you in the future, I got to deliver on those promises, or I'll be the former supervisor from Stanislaus County. But thank you again for the opportunity to speak today on behalf of Stancog and myself. I think the partnership with the CTC, I look forward to continuing to work and doing great things. So thank you very much.
Fantastic. We would really appreciate it if you and Ms. Park would stay at the mic, because we have some questions for you and comments. So let me first call on Chair-elect Eager, and then Vice-Chair-elect Gardino, and then Commissioner Inman, and then I have some questions of my own.
Thank you. Thank you, Supervisor Chiesa. It's nice to see you. I'm so glad you mentioned the issue about the air quality in the Central Valley, and this is certainly one of those projects that will assist with that. You know, one of the things that we forget to bring up is those trucks that sit idly on our freeways and what that does to the air quality in the Central Valley. And so getting our trucks from one place to the other quickly, safely, in order to get our products out of the Central Valley and into other places or vice versa. As the supervisor said, you know, the majority of the food that gets distributed around the state of California and really all over the country come right out of the Central Valley. And so making sure that those trucks don't sit idly on our freeways. So for me, I just wanted to say thank you for doing the work that you're doing. And the Inland Port is going to be an important project. So we really look forward to hearing about the progress of that in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Very well said. Did you want to comment, Ms. Park, or on the Inland Port goals and safety issues?
Yeah, especially as you're moving away from the route right in the middle of Modesto.
This is an effort, thank you. It's an effort that we're working with Fresno COG, and so Robert Phipps is probably they're the leads, but we're in support of that. We all came together to support that effort and the grant funding for that.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Commissioner Eager. Commissioner Gardino. You're muted.
Thank you, Chair Norton and Supervisor. We want to do our best to partner with you to make sure you stay a supervisor for a good long time to come. Thanks for your comments about air quality as well. I share that those goals and that concern. And welcome to the family of self-help counties and your efforts to continue to work with your voters to get them to a place where they could embrace on a two-thirds vote your ambitious goals to improve your region.
Thank you.
I should provide context for that expression. I've had the pleasure of leading or co-leading 7 county sales tax campaigns, 6 of them successfully here in the Bay Area. And that's always a daunting task to get to two-thirds, but with the right packet of improvements and with the right communications to our neighbors, we've been able to get those passed, and we're delighted to be working with you.
Excellent. I'd like to call on Commissioner Inman.
Thank you, Chair Norton, and thanks to our partners for your comments today. Just want to appreciate the focus on the goods movement sector and the importance of our ag industry. We've got a select committee on ports and goods movement hearing coming up. I think it's the 2nd. I might have the date wrong. But, you know, we've all been struggling with the hiccups, and I would argue that they get magnified when you have time-sensitive goods that you're moving with expiration dates on them from our ag industry. And we do feed the world through our ag industry in California. So just want to encourage it and recognize the importance of really looking at what does it mean when you have high volumes of trucks on those corridors and the sensitivity on the air quality when they're not moving. I mean, the idling, San Joaquin is one of our districts that we really have to work hard for our air quality. Yeah. And so I think it's really, really important, and appreciate the work. And I know they've done multi-regional plans because our freight doesn't just automatically stop at one border. So just want to lean in and salute the focus on that and the attention to it, because what we've found is freight's going to find a way. And if we plan early and we plan often, we can get it right. But if not, it's not just going to happen. So I just want to encourage everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.
I appreciate those comments too, because you're preaching to the choir here. And I apologize also, Chair, that I didn't think you guys were going to see me in blue jeans. So I didn't know I was going to be standing with the camera. I would have wore a suit. I apologize.
It's okay. We care a lot about what you say and less about what you wear. So what you had to say was wonderful. I did want to add a few questions because I remember in the previous, 2 years ago hearings, one of the things that was talked about a lot of the ag industry and our former chair, Paul Van Kneinberg, was the concern about what's happening with road degradation and issues of pavement warping. Because as one person pointed out, when you watch a 80-ton milk truck sink into the roads because it can't move and it's in the heat, it's really troublesome. And so I wanted to ask you, not only with goods movement in agriculture, but as we're moving to new fuels and the potential for heavier trucks because of different fuel tanks or batteries, what is being planned in terms of new pavement and new innovations for charging, but also just how are we going to add broadband? How are we going to make sure that with the advent of the high amount of freight we need to move, but the heavy weight of each of the vehicles, how you are going to be doing these new construction projects so that we can address the fact that we have had in the hot sun all this warping, and that has been an actual safety issue, not just for cars, but especially for bicycles and other vehicles that are trying to use these roadways after the freight vehicles are on them in the heat.
Thank you for that comment. And actually, this is something Public Works, and when you're talking to them across the state, this is something that they are looking into. And in our region, and particularly our Public Works director has made those comments of making things differently. So they are having plans. And regionally, we're doing a pavement management program planned here for the region. And a lot of these things are going to be considered. So thank you. That's something they
thank are you. Working on. That's very forward thinking of you, and we really appreciate hearing that, and we'd love to hear back from you as to the innovations you're making in these pavement management programs. I know you also wanted to comment, so.
I just wanted to say that our Public Works Director, we have always encouraged him to be innovative, to try different things, and we did I would call it a country road, but a lot of agriculture was planted east on the eastern foothills. And so these roads were single lane, absolutely destroyed it with the 80,000 pound trucks continually going over it. And he got a grant, a small grant, and went out and put some, it was a pavement mix of some cement along with, and you're probably a lot more familiar, but again, I encourage it. If it fails, we'll go back and we'll fix it. But until we start dealing with it, because we know rubberized cuts down on noise, but we need to either go to triples, right? Not put any more weight on each tire per se, but to put longer trucks. And that's very difficult in California because we weren't set up for it. And so we continue to try and be innovative. We encourage our Public Works Director to do that along with the COG.
This is fascinating because as we're looking at state of good repair and life of projects, this is exactly the kind of innovation we're looking for. And so we want to thank you for putting the time into it and also to look at how we can accelerate conversion to zero emission vehicles so that we're reducing the impact on air quality, but also looking at what that means in the public works environment to have, stronger pavement and other things that can be companions to that acceleration to zero emission freight.
Thank you.
Absolutely. With that, Casey, I think we'll go next to Calaveras COG. Thank you so much for your great input.
Thank you. Calaveras Council of Governments is available on page 8 of the hearing book. Calaveras proposes to program one new project totaling $4.5 million to the design phase of the Route 4 Wagon Trail Realignment Eastern Segment Project. This proposal exceeds their maximum target of 3.1 million, but is within the section 188.8J, limited authorized for small counties. And Amber, I see that you're online and available. I'll hand it over to you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon. It's afternoon now. Okay. Madam Chair and Commissioners, first want to congratulate Ms. Eager and Mr. Gardino on the appointment of Chair and Vice Chair. We do look forward to your leadership this year as we navigate, as you know, all the changes that are going on in the state and federal level. Want to thank you for giving us this time to speak about our proposed RTIP. As Casey introduced me, I'm the Executive Director of the Calaveras Council of Governments. And for some of you who don't know, Calaveras County is located just east of Stockton, in the foothills in eastern Sierra Nevada mountain range. So on a map, we're not too far away from you, but sometimes it feels like we're a million miles away. I want to thank CTC for your leadership in the STIP. Our RTIP funds are critical to our small rural region as it affords us the opportunity to leverage other funds to deliver regionally significant and comprehensive corridor projects that yield multiple benefits for us, such as our RTIP project, which is the State Route 4 Wagon Trail Realignment Project. Actually, attending with me this afternoon to speak on COG's behalf is Calaveras County Supervisor Gary Tofanelli. He serves as our COG Chair, and County Supervisor Amanda Follendorf, who serves as our COG Vice Chair. And I know we only have 5 minutes, so I'm going to go ahead and try to hand it off to Supervisor Tofanelli first to speak about our request, if he's on the line.
Can you hear me? Ready?
We can hear you now, yes.
You can hear me, hi.
Yes.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair and Commissioners. First, I wanna thank you on behalf of Calaveras County for your continued support. In partnership on this project, along with Caltrans. It's been very nice to have this participation from all of you. We have we got funding last year from CTC to start our phase one of this project. We will start construction sometime in mid-March, the first part of April. We will be having a groundbreaking ceremony the first week of March, and Amber will send out invites to each commissioner to attend it. We'd certainly like to see you there if you can make it. Just a little background on myself real quick. I have been on COG for many, many years as a supervisor, and I've been on this project, working on this project since 2008. And it's very pleasing to me and my constituents to see this moving along. We're down to the, after we build the first phase, we're down to the last 2.3 miles of this phase of wagon trail project. And it will complete the corridor all the way from the valley up to Alpine County and Bear Valley and on to Highway 89. The reason for our asking of 4.5 million is when we came before the commission last year, we had a shovel ready project for this first phase. We're looking for the money for the engineering and design of the second phase and the final phase of this project. And that 4.5 million will allow us to do that. We will be shovel ready and looking for funding after that. And as said before, for the major safety reasons for evacuation route, major evacuation routes from our county, and we've had some number of disasters over the course of the last few years, including the Tamarack fire last year, this would be a major course for evacuations. But I also sit on Mountain Valley EMS Agency, which is a JPA that provides ambulance service and other emergency services to five counties, Alpine, Amador, Calaveras, Mariposa, and Stanislaus. And this is a major route that's been used for trauma victims because in Alpine, Amador, and Mariposa, our hospitals are not equipped for trauma. So we have to transport them down to Stanislaus County in the Modesto area. And this is, it's very dangerous and very slow process going through these last 2.3 miles because it is the most treacherous part of this highway that needs to be worked on. So it'd
be major improvement for servicing those patients that need to be transported quickly down to the valley. I really appreciate the time that you've given me to speak, and I would like at this point to pass it on to Supervisor Fallendorf, whose district this goes through, this project goes through.
Thank you, Supervisor.
Good afternoon. I am Supervisor Amanda Fallendorf. I previously served as the mayor of the city of Angels, which Highway 4 corridor ran through the only incorporated city in the county. This Gary has hit all of the fine points of the safety, emergency evacuation route, as well as getting emergency vehicles in and out of our this stretch of the corridor. This is really dear to my heart because my father previously was on the city council of Angels and was on the original formation of the Council of Cog for Calaveras Council. And he saw this project from the beginning. So I remember seeing this as a child, him talking and seeing this, and now as a second generation, being involved in the local government, being able to come to you and request and partner with this to see this finally completed after all these years. I think we all know that a lot of engineers start projects and then they see these projects done at the end of their retirement, and that's kind of like what we're seeing here is that in the local level. So I would appreciate the opportunity and partnership on behalf of the Calaveras County with the CTC to support this project as it is a primary safety and commute area down to the valley. Thank you.
Thank you for your great testimony. Ms. Collins, is there more of the presentation you'd like to make?
I don't believe so. I think the supervisors hit on the main points. Obviously our request is asking for a $2.3 million advance from our shares so we can expedite shovel-ready status so we can compete for other funds to get to construction on this last phase. And thank you again for considering our request and the opportunity to speak today.
Thank you. We have no public comment on the Calaveras COG presentation. Are there any comments from commissioners? Okay, hearing none, thank you so much. Appreciate your time. Casey, I wanted to ask if we could move up the SACOG presentation. There is a participant who has a time constraint. I was wondering if we could. Okay.
Thank you. So SACOG is the Sacramento Area Council for Governments. SACOG covers four counties. As shown in the STIP hearing book, Sacramento on pages 48 and 49, Sutter on page 78, Yolo page 85, and Yuba page 86. Similar to the MTC region, SACOG can pool their shares amongst the four counties I just listed. Overall, SACOG is proposing to add programming totaling $21.838 million, which is $27.4 million below their target of $49.24 million. Sacramento is proposing to delete two highway projects and one transit project totaling $33.1 million, adding seven new projects totaling $12.4 million, and increasing funds to two existing projects totaling $7.8 million. Although the proposed programming adds $19.5 million in the first 3 years, that is an offset by the deletions resulting in a net negative $13.7 million reduction in the earlier years of the STIP. Mm-hmm. Sutter is proposing to program three new projects in Sacramento County totaling $11.5 million in the first 2 years of the STIP. Yolo is proposing to add two new projects totaling $8.1 million in the first 2 years of the STIP. And Yuba is proposing to add one new project in Yolo County totaling $8.7 million for construction in fiscal year 24-25. They are also proposing to increase $4 million to an existing project in Sacramento County in prior year, which is not allowable. And that concludes my remarks. I will go ahead and hand it over to Christina I apologize if I butcher your last name. I'm not even going to attempt, but Christina is the Director of Transportation with SACOG, and I'll hand it over to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. No, it's a tricky one with one vowel, so thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. As Casey mentioned, I'm Christina Spence, Director of Transportation at SACOG. I am somewhat newer to the agency and might be a new face here for many, so I just want to let you all know I look forward to working with all of you more. I would like to begin by acknowledging and expressing appreciation for the leadership of Chair Norton and Vice Chair Alvarado. I also want to share congratulations and welcome incoming Chair Eager and Vice Chair Gordino. We anticipate a strong working relationship over the coming year with both you and the Commission as a whole. I'd also like to share that we appreciate the workshops leading up to today and the excellent communication from your staff, especially Teresa Favila and Juan Guzman. Overall, we have not included one single large project within our STIP that we're focusing on. Instead, the STIP is centered on prioritizing the maintenance of infrastructure and making our transportation effective and safe for all users. The projects will help our region achieve the goals of our long-range plan. Our STIP does include 13 new projects, 11 of which are complete streets projects. So this aligns our STIP with SACOG goals, but also state initiatives like CAPDI, not to mention many at the federal level that are emerging from IIJA. We programmed $16 million of new or increased project programming in the first 3 years of the STIP. We believe this is a reasonable request. The schedule is consistent with what our sponsors can and will deliver, so putting them in later years would be inaccurate and, more importantly, would force delays in projects that are ready to go. In developing the STIP, we conducted a competitive funding round in which we awarded funds to Caltrans District 3, our cities, counties, and transit operators. We're leaving some STIP shares unprogrammed. This is because we're working to fully fund the construction phase of projects scheduled for the later years of the STIP. You may also notice projects in Sacramento County that use the shares of other counties. That's because SACOG pools its county shares. The RTIP only shows how a portion of our projects are proposed for the programming. As RTPA for the four counties of Sacramento, Sutter, Yolo, and Yuba, we program multiple fund sources in addition to the STIP, CMAQ, RFTP, HIP, and CRISA, in a broad multi-county competitive funding round. We use these funds to implement our six county regions long-range plan. So I just want to say thank you again for taking the time to consider our STIP, both Jose Luis Caceres, who's here with me today. Welcome any questions you may have. Thank you very much.
Wonderful. Commissioners, do you have any questions of SACOG right now?
Madam Chair, I do.
Commissioner Grisby, thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And Christina, thank you for the presentation. For me as commissioner, there's two important considerations for thinking about capacity enhancements. That would be safety and goods movement. I noticed there's a reference to connector segment A. I think it's, I can't pronounce the road. Is that for the Southeast Expressway?
Jose
Luis
is on.
Yes, good afternoon. Let me pull up the project. We have four counties. This is
Sacramento.
Yes, Sacramento. We're asking about Kemmerer. Yes, that is a section of the connector. Did you have a question, Commissioner?
Sure. I just wonder what the goals are for that new expressway. So I noticed on the map that there seems to be still agricultural lands nearby. Just wondering what role that expressway will serve.
Christina, did you want to answer that, or would you like me to?
You can go ahead.
This area, I don't know if you've had the chance to visit it. There are residents and farmers all interacting in the same area. This road, I went out there myself. I had to go pick up something off of Craigslist. Just about died. There's no shoulders on a bunch of these roads, tight turns, elevation changes. They were made for farmers, by farmers, but they are used today for driving, not just for residents, but for agricultural. This is, it's a connection for current and future residents and for the existing agricultural and industrial uses. Yeah, it is a goods movement corridor. It's a safety concern. Did that answer your question?
It did, yeah. I guess, are there plans for new housing subdivisions in that area, or is it going to remain kind of a mixture of greenfield and existing?
I actually don't know the housing forecast for that, and I could follow up, unless, Christina, you have any of that.
I think the general answer would be yes, but I think we have a lot that we're doing as part of our update to our MTP right now that has more detail on that that we'd be happy to share.
And we can follow up with them, Commissioner Grisby, and get you more information from SACOG. Okay?
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner Grisby. Now I'd like to recognize Commissioner Davis.
Actually, that was going to be the question I was going to ask, the last part of, but what's the residential build out going to be there, and what's the anticipated additional miles traveled on those roads once they take all these fields and sort of build them out like they have all the way from I-50 now to in Rancho Cordova, almost all the way across. I'd be looking forward to that answer.
Absolutely, we'll follow up with you.
Great. Are there other commissioners who have other questions? We have no we have no public comment on this presentation. And really, this is extremely helpful as we're looking at what was promised in self-help measures, what you are building out that are part of these commitments, and then how we're seeing this network into a system that's going to reduce VMT and improve greenhouse gas emissions. So we appreciate that you are thinking along these lines all the time and really trying to knit this together into a network.
Thank you.
Are there anything else you want to highlight along those lines for us?
I would like to address a comment from commission staff. I was not aware of it, but I'm seeing it now. We have a $4 million increase to a Caltrans project, and it just got put in the wrong column. It should be in 22-23, not in prior. I'll follow up with CTC staff to correct that.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Appreciate your time. Thank you for your presentation.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Casey, who is our next presenter?
Humboldt County Association of Governments. Humboldt County is available on pages 16 and 17. Humboldt proposes to program 5 new projects in the first 3 years of the STIP, totaling $3.5 million. Two of the projects include $1.2 million in COVID shares. They also propose to add right-of-way and construction of $1.5 million in fiscal year 22-23 to the existing Greenwood Railroad and Hatchery Road, a Blue Lake Truck Route Improvements Project. And I will go ahead and hand it over to Beth Burks, Executive Director. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Chair Norton, Commissioners. My name is Beth Burks, and I am the Executive Director of the Humboldt County Association of Governments. And this is my first opportunity to present to your commission, and I am very glad to be here today. This was also my first time going through the STIP cycle, so I do want to start with just a thank you to CTC staff, especially Casey, who has been incredibly helpful, diligent, and patient with me as I navigate this process. And she's just been really wonderful to work with, and I'm proud of the product we were able to get to. So in terms of our projects, over the last 20 years, HCOG has dedicated a significant amount of our RIP shares for the Arcata Eureka Safety Corridor Project along Highway 101. This is our region's top safety concern, and the HCOG has been dedicated to finishing this project. It's just about to go out to bid. So we did need to reserve some of this year's programming capacity for anticipated cost overruns. Just like everything else, you know, we're expecting construction costs to go up. So we did want to reserve that because we are committed to seeing that project be completed. But we were also delighted to actually have some funding to work with to, after many years, be able to really spread this money around our region and address some very important projects that we've been looking forward to for a long time. And our projects do highlight and promote safety for the most part, and active transportation is another area of focus for many of our projects. So the first is the Blue Lake Truck Route. I want to just kind of highlight these because I think some of our rural flavor will come through in some of these examples. The truck route is one that's a continuing project. In Blue Lake, the truck route bisects the town and is the primary transportation route for a vast array of uses, including commercial timberlands, gravel mining. It's also the main road where the only elementary school is located, and it's where City Hall is located. Residences are there. So we have a lot going on in a little town on a really busy road. There are narrow sidewalks that are not ADA compliant, and there are no bike lanes. Another unique feature to this area is that the Annie and Mary Trail, which is a commuter and recreational trail, crosses the truck route. And the really special thing, among others, about the Annie and Mary Trail is it will become the northernmost segment of the Great Redwood Trail. This is where, depending on where you start or finish, the Great Redwood Trail will begin or end. So this project, with the STIP funding, it covers a portion of the design or all of the design and a portion of construction to redesign the entire truck route with a focus on safety and active transportation, and will position Blue Lake for the increase in visitors once the Great Redwood Trail becomes a reality. So another project I wanted to highlight was a roundabout and pedestrian improvements. This is for the environmental phase for a project in Fortuna. Fortuna is a town that is bisected by Highway 101, and currently there is no way for pedestrians or cyclists to safely get across from the main part of town that has downtown and the residential area to the area on the west across the highway, which is the Riverwalk area, which has an array of commercial and recreational opportunities. And so this is a part of a much bigger plan that will help facilitate really connecting that community back together and getting everybody to be able to use a mode other than cars to get around. And then the final project I wanted to highlight is another roundabout project. This is in the city of Arcata, and this is at an intersection that is one of the main points of entry between the community and California's newest polytechnic university, Cal Poly Humboldt, as of yesterday. And this project will help to improve safety for all modes of transportation, especially since the university, now that it's a polytechnic, is anticipating doubling the student population in the next 5 years. Other program projects include sidewalk infill and road rehabilitation. We really were able to maximize the limited funding we have and put forward projects that really help various parts of our region. While most of our projects could be initiated today if the funding was available, we understand the restrictions in the early years of the STIP. We did try to maximize our COVID relief funds in those early years so that we could move forward projects that were time sensitive. We also did provide our priority listing for which projects to consider moving forward first if funding becomes available sooner than anticipated. So we look forward to working with commission staff on mapping out exactly which years we could have access to the funding. With that, I'll close my presentation and just say thank you for your support and consideration, and happy to take any questions.
Well, thank you so much. We have no public comment at this time on the HCAOG presentation, but I wanted to ask if any of our commissioners wanted to provide some comments, or if Teresa had any comments. Commissioners?
I do not, Chair Norton, but I just want to commend Beth on her new role. The STIP is the easiest but the most complicated program. And so good job, Beth.
Thank you. Yes.
And we're very excited about the new Polytechnic University at Humboldt. So that is wonderful.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. And we are looking forward to seeing these pedestrian crossings and making sure that active transportation can also have a network, despite places where that may seem difficult for now, but not insurmountable. And so we'll be looking at all of these new ways to see how we're making sure that people who are participating in active transportation are getting these new venues so that we can continue to have a multimodal system that doesn't even involve vehicles at this point. With that, Commissioner-elect Eager is, I mean, Chair-elect Eager, Commissioner Eager, what would you like to add to that? I think you're muted.
Just to add, welcome, Beth. And I know this was your first time. You did a great job. Mm-hmm. So we appreciate your comments, and especially we hear over and over again how helpful the CTC staff is with getting you through these processes. And we know they're really difficult. So thank you for acknowledging the staff. We know they're amazing, but we still like to hear it every time. So thank you.
Great point. Thank you again. We look forward to working with you throughout the entire process.
Thank you.
Thank you. With that, Casey, who do we have up next?
Next, we'll start with San Luis Obispo County, also known as SLOCOG. San Luis Obispo is available on pages 58 and 59. San Luis Obispo proposes, to add $9.4 million to existing programming, $9 million in the first 3 years. Of the proposed programming, $1.7 million for the new Route 101 Route 46 off-ramp improvements project. One of the existing projects, Route 101 Pismo Beach southbound congestion relief, includes $2.3 million in COVID shares in fiscal years 22-23. The project will also seek SB1 funds for construction. Their proposal exceeds their target of $8.3 million. And my remarks are concluded, and I will go ahead and hand it over to Pete Rogers, Executive Director. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair Norton, and good to see you. And hello, commissioners and CTC staff. You're fantastic. Also, congrats to the new leadership, and you know, kudos to Commissioner Alvarado for his long tenure. Let me first thank the commission for their support of the 46 corridor earlier today. I know that was a heavy lift and a big deal, so I really appreciate it. I also know that everybody's stomachs are growling, and I promise not to go on too long. You know, San Luis Obispo in the north-south split is in the southern part, and today's the North County hearing. I apologize for that, but you know, it feels like there's more 49ers fans here than Rams fans, so it just felt like kind of right to participate today. But seriously, I'll be on a plane next week, so I really appreciate you allowing me to come today. Over the course of the 21 calendar year, we had 8 public meetings on our RTIP. The directors and the public are well informed about the many issues and investment choices we're making on our RTIP. We had strong support from the public and the board. We did hit a bump in the road with a non-funded project, which is basically our Highways to Boulevard project, which is on Highway 227. If you know San Luis Obispo, it's by the airport. We really appreciate the flexibility of CTC staff on our submitting our RTIP and the timing that we did. And speaking of CTC staff, there are 2 minor technical corrections in our RTIP on PPNO 2830 and 2653. Those 2 projects will benefit what the commission is trying to do with the over-programming years, and our staff will tell you about those details. In short, our 22 RTIP remains committed to the investment choices and the project priorities we defined in this region for the past 4 STIP cycles. As you know, we are not a self-help county here. In fact, we hold the record for the closest fail in 2016 at 0.3% fail. Not 1%, but less than that, 0.3% fail. Many of us still want to be in that club. Alas, we are an aspiring county, and we are trying to maximize local contributions and leverage grants and local funds to round out our investment strategies. The investment strategies won't be any surprises to you. It's Highway 101 and 46. Our north-south main line is the lifeline in our county. With District 5 support, SLOCOG remains committed to completing all pre-construction activities for the 101 peak hour managed lane project in Pismo Beach, along with fully funding all the pre-construction activities, including right-of-way. SLOCOG's recent commitments are leading the development efforts and commits 10% toward the construction costs of this project using both STIP and federal discretionary dollars in the amount of about $5 or $6 million. We hope these funds will leverage SB 1 Solutions for Congested Corridor grant application, because our total grant ask or total construction cost there is around $60 million. On the Highway 46 project, we've heard about that a lot today already. You've noticed the ghost of James Dean behind me, I hope. Highway 46 connects US 101 to Interstate 5. It's a key east-west connection to the Central Valley and a key freight corridor. You heard Todd Muck talk about the salad bowl, and salad's got to go east. So you also heard Commissioner Eager talk about the need to get to the beach every now and then. You know, there's a million people between Bakersfield, Visalia, and Fresno that do use that corridor to come over to the coast. Thank you again for your support earlier today on the efforts for the ITIP funding and the construction cost increases for the Chelan and Y segments of the 46 East Corridor, and reaffirming commitments to the design and final phase of Antelope Grade. SLOCOG will continue to pursue existing and new federal RAISE grant funding to offset any state funding needed for the capital phases of the future projects. You know, there's nearly a half a billion dollars invested in the widening of 46 East for a safe four-lane divided highway. SLOCOG's RTIP is also addressing the throughput deficiencies in the urban area of the corridor, more towards Paso Robles. We do support the efforts of Paso Robles to secure Trade One corridor funding and local partnership program funding to improve the parallel route system network north of 46 and construct the Phase One overpass at Union Road and 46, which will reduce local traffic from using this important freight corridor. Infrastructure to address safe access on and off Highway 46 at the confluence of 101 remains and will be our region's next priority focus area. Pre-construction investments for two interchanges at Union Road and 101-46 remain in SLOCOG's RTIP to address these issues. And finally, I did want to mention in our support for the King City rail platform project and the ITIP, you know, that's going to be a real game changer for the Salinas Valley. And, you know, the benefits of Fort Hunter Liggett go further than most of us probably realize. And with that, I will end and hope to meet some of you all in San Diego for the commission meeting. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I did want to ask you, with the focus on the 46 and the need for it, especially for safety, we have at the commission talked about the need to, when we increase capacity, that we have what I call the three M's, manage, multimodal, and meaningful. And we definitely have the meaningful for addressing the issues. Safety and others. I wanted to ask about the multimodal and the managed and what your vision might be for those two things as well.
You know, that's a good question. We do provide public transit services out to Shandon, and we're working with Amtrak and the Thruway bus carriers to do open door service on the corridor. You know, in the past, you've always had to have a rail ticket, but that would really expand the options for east-west mm-hmm. travel if you didn't have to have an Amtrak ticket going north or south when you get here.
That's fantastic. We really appreciate that. And I think the more that we can hear of those, that connectivity, the better. But we appreciate that you've been holding the course on the 46 and the need for the addressing the safety issues. So thank you so much for your time. We have no public comment. Are there other commissioners who wanted to speak on this presentation? Also, we noticed James Dean in the background as watching over the safety issues in this area.
Oh, I didn't even know he's there.
Oh. Commissioner Inman wanted to know that she pointed that out as well. So thank you so much for your time, and we look forward to working with you throughout this process. Have a great afternoon.
Thank you.
Uh-huh. Next, Casey.
Next is Mendocino Council of Governments. Mendocino County is available in the STIP hearing on pages 33 and 34. Mendocino is proposing to program $347,000 in regular shares, which is $4.943 million below their target. They are also proposing COVID funds totaling $1.2 million, including $960,000
$6,000 for three new projects and increases for two existing projects. With that, I will go ahead and hand it over to Nathalie Barrett, Executive Director of MCOG.
Thank you.
Great. Good afternoon, commissioners. Hopefully you can hear me okay. I'm going to try to keep my camera on, but my bandwidth is not great. So if it's a problem, I will switch off. So I'm Nathalie Barrett, Executive Director of the Mendocino Council of Governments. Thank you for this opportunity to speak on the Mendocino County Regional Transportation Improvement Program, and thanks to staff for their ongoing help and support. Thank you to the outgoing chair and vice chair, and we look forward to working with commissioners Eager and Gradino going forward in their new roles. And a special thank you to Commissioner Alvarado for his many years of service on the commission. So I'll be brief today because our RTIP is small. And although this RTIP is proposing very little new programming, we've actually earmarked the majority of our unprogrammed balance for future use on projects that currently have project development programmed in the STIP. With limited funding availability, it often takes us multiple cycles to save up enough money to be able to fully program projects. So the projects in the RTIP focus on safety and operational improvements on both the local and state system. They represent improvements across a variety of modes and throughout the very large Mendocino County region. Some highlights of the projects include a second phase of the Ukiah Downtown Streetscape project, which will extend improvements of a recently completed road diet and streetscape project in the city of Ukiah, which is transforming the city's downtown by reducing a former state highway from four lanes down to two travel lanes, widening sidewalks, adding large bulb outs to shorten crossings, adding planters and decorative lighting and street trees. First phase of the project has significantly calmed traffic and improved safety for all users, as well as beautified the downtown area. Two projects in the RTIP will add walking and bicycling facilities where none currently exist along State Route 1 in the communities of Fort Bragg and Wallala, where the highway serves as Main Street. The RTIP also includes two roundabout projects, one that will improve operations and safety for all modes of transportation at two key intersections in the Ukiah area at the interchange of US 101 and State Street, a busy arterial on our local system. Another roundabout project will improve operations and safety at a very busy intersection in a school zone that provides access to four different area schools. The COVID relief STIP programming included in the RTIP includes funds for a critical bridge replacement project, local street rehab, and additional funding for a project that will construct a portion of the Great Redwood Trail through the city of Willits. So I'd also like to just take this opportunity to mention the importance of the STIP program in general in our region. The STIP has historically been one of the main funding sources for larger capital improvements available to us other than through statewide competitive programs. As a rural county, we receive low funding amounts through population-based sources and are ineligible for some sources. However, the STIP considers both population and road mileage in its distribution formula, which is important in a county with a population of only about 90,000, but with nearly 1,200 centerline miles of local agency roadway responsibility and 390 centerline miles of state highway. I mention this today because I understand there's potential for the proposed pause in the excise tax increase to impact the STIP, but we're hopeful that these impacts will be minimized and we'll be able to continue moving forward with these important projects. So that includes my report today, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you so much. I see that we have no public comment on these items. So commissioners, are there any observations you wanted to make on the Mendocino Council of Governments? I did want to ask you, especially since you had announced the issues with your Wi-Fi, what you're doing in terms of the plans for broadband and incorporating those access options and the development projects you're talking about, how we can have this sort of dig once and dig smart so that we can expand broadband access for all. And still do it in a way that won't then go back and disrupt the projects that you're planning right now.
Absolutely. It is a critical issue, particularly in some of the more remote areas of Mendocino County. We do have a countywide organization, a broadband coalition that's working on that. They have been actively applying for grants to upgrade broadband in some of those more remote areas. There are also efforts to improve access in the more centralized areas. And so we're working with that coalition to make sure that we're not putting in improvements where new broadband access is likely to go. However, with limited funding means we also have a limited number of projects moving forward. So it makes it easier to coordinate with those efforts as well as make sure that we're not digging up new pavement once it's placed.
Thank you so much. With that, I don't see any of my colleagues wishing to speak, so I want to thank you for your presentation, and we will move on to our next presentation. Casey, thank you very much, Billy.
Next up is Nevada County Transportation Commission, also known as NCTC. Nevada County is available on page 41. Nevada is proposing to program $3.117 million, which includes adding the right-of-way phase to the State Route 49 Corridor Improvements Project for $3 million. They are also partnering with Caltrans to fund this phase. And with that, I will pass it on to Mike Woodman, Executive Director of Nevada County Transportation Commission.
Chair Norton, fellow commissioners, thank you for the opportunity to speak with you today. Wanted to talk to you today to voice our support for Caltrans ITIP recommendation to program $3 million towards the right-of-way for the State Route 49 Corridor Improvement Project and our NCTC's RTIP proposal. This Caltrans ITIP investment will leverage a total of $11.1 million, which includes $8.1 million of NCTC's previously programmed RIP shares that went towards project development, and the additional $3 million that's proposed in NCTC's RTIP program. We really appreciate Caltrans' partnership. This is a critical key corridor for Nevada County. This project will improve multimodal safety, operations, connectivity, accessibility, goods movement, and evacuation readiness. And again, it's a top priority for the Nevada County Transportation Commission, and it is supported by the community. The State Route 49 Corridor Improvement Project includes construction of a southbound truck climbing lane, 10-foot shoulders, and eliminates existing lane drop merge points south of the McKnight Way interchange. The ultimate project is designed to be built in phases, and this moves this project forward. In alignment with CAPTI, the project will not significantly increase VMT. The State Route 49 Corridor Improvement Project has been determined to be exempt from air quality conformity by EPA and the Air Quality Conformity Working Group, consisting of representatives from FHWA, FTA, Caltrans, NCTC, and the Northern Sierra Air Quality Management District. The project reduces both air quality pollutants for ozone precursors in Western Nevada County ozone non-attainment area and greenhouse gas emissions. The State Route 49 Corridor Improvement Project will also help to facilitate mode shift within the corridor, improving operations. The State Route 49 Corridor plays a key role in providing interregional multimodal connectivity as an interregional public transit corridor, providing expressed fixed route transit service between Nevada and Placer County, and providing connections to the Amtrak Capital Corridor, Intercity Passenger Rail, Auburn Transit, Placer County Transit, at the Auburn Coheim Multimodal Station in Placer County. The State Route 49 Corridor Improvement Project will also implement bicycle and pedestrian improvements identified in the Nevada County Active Transportation Plan and the State Route 49 Comprehensive Multimodal Corridor Plan, including the addition of 10-foot shoulders along the State Route 49 corridor to improve pedestrian and bicycle safety and help to encourage additional mode shift within the corridor. This will provide enhanced mobility through the elimination of the existing gaps in the shoulder and provide a safe and continuous network of facilities. Bicyclists and pedestrians are frequently observed navigating the project segment, and this project will provide safe accessibility for the residential areas adjacent to the State Route 49 corridor that are identified as AB 1550 communities that are below the statewide median income. The project segment is also designated as a critical rural freight corridor by the Federal Highway Administration and serves as an emergency detour route when I-80 is closed between Immigrant Gap and Colfax due to either accidents, wildfire, maintenance activities, or construction. The most recent I-80 emergency detours occurred on July 3rd and September 10th in 2021, and data collected by Caltrans District 3 Traffic Management indicate between 2004 and 2021, there have been 218 closures of I-80 where truck traffic and passenger vehicles were detoured onto State Route 20 and then onto State Route 49. It's estimated that $4 to $8 million in commerce travels over Donner Summit every hour, underlining the importance of State Route 49 as an emergency detour route. Additionally, this project is located within a CAL FIRE very high fire hazard severity zone, and the construction of the planned improvements on State Route 49 will make this segment more resilient to the risk of wildfire by reducing roadside vegetation fuel loads and eliminate the existing design features that constrict traffic flow in the event of evacuation. During the recent river fire in August of 2021, previous concerns raised by our local partner agencies and emergency responders were verified when the highway in its current configuration operationally broke down, resulting in accidents and a fatality. This was with only 4,000 residents evacuated. Safety and evacuation readiness are the biggest concern of the citizens in Nevada County, and they support this project. This project truly improves safety and operations on State Route 49 and addresses the multimodal needs in the segment of the corridor and is supported by Senator Brian Dolly, Assemblywoman Megan Dolly, CAL FIRE NEU, CHP Grass Valley, Nevada County Consolidated Fire District, Citizens for Highway 49 Safety, Fix49.org, the Nevada County Accessible Transportation Coalition, Mobility Action Partners, and Nevada County Office of Emergency Services, and the California Trucking Association. NCTC, on behalf of the State Route 49 Coalition of Stakeholders, urges support for Caltrans ITIP funding and NCTC's RTIP proposal, and NCTC looks forward to continued partnership with the department and the commission to deliver this project and other planned projects in the State Route 49 corridor. Following completion of this project in the 13-mile corridor, we'll still have about 8 miles left to complete where we have planned projects identified. So we continue to do our best with the available funding and turn over every stone and chase every opportunity for partnership with the department and our federal partners, and look forward to continue to work to improve the safety and operations of this corridor. So thank you, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
I think there are no other comments at this time, and I see we have no public comment. Commissioners, are you wishing to speak on this item? If not, Casey, let's move to the Shasta Regional Transportation Agency.
Thank you, Chair Norton. So Shasta Regional Transportation Agency, also known as SRTA, is available on pages 68 and 69 of the STIP hearing book. Shasta is proposing to add one new project totaling $2.5 million in fiscal year 26-27 and adding $4.6 million to an existing project for construction in fiscal year 24-25. The project will also seek SB1 funds. This proposal exceeds their maximum target, but it is within their section 188.8J limit. And that concludes my remarks. So I will go ahead and pass it over to Dan Wayne, Senior Transportation Planner for SRTA. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dan Wayne. We're looking forward to talking to you.
Great. Thank you, Casey, Chair Norton, and commissioners. First, I'd like to thank the CTC and state agency partners for their policy leadership, and more importantly, for connecting these aspirational outcomes to funding priorities and decision-making. You know, when supported by programming, state policies help us lead the development of more sustainable projects that benefit all Californians. Our 2022 RTIP includes three active transportation projects that fit within our growing network of high quality active transportation facilities and one highway project. And today I'd like to focus my comments on the Fix 5 Cascade Gateway project. In recent years, the effects of climate change have profoundly impacted the Shasta region in the form of severe weather and wildfire events. The regional transportation system has proven to be vulnerable in these instances. Over the last 5 years, northbound I-5 closures have occurred 18 to 26 times per year.
Wow.
And this is more than double the historical averages. And the frequency and severity of precipitating events is forecast to increase according to recently completed sustainability and resilience studies. It's not uncommon for closures on I-5 to last multiple days and for traffic to back up over 10 miles through the cities of Shasta Lake, Redding, and Anderson. And at such times, the I-5 corridor and multiple interchanges become gridlocked, including the designated detour route for I-5. Freight movement grinds to a halt and local roadways are overwhelmed by diverted and overflow traffic. SRTA and Caltrans District 2, in consultation with local agencies and community stakeholders, have developed a scope of work that is innovative and pragmatic in the context of the North State. I'd like to highlight three major components of the Fix 5 Cascade Gateway project. First, managed lanes will be introduced for 5.2 miles on northbound I-5 through the city of Redding. This is a first in the North State. Overhead changeable message signs and ITS elements will enable Caltrans traffic operations to dynamically assign lanes based on trip purpose, by vehicle type, by a major incident, or for travel demand management. And during I-5 closure events, the outside number 3 lane will be designated exit and detour only in order to maintain free flow traffic to the designated alternate route, and also keep that lane open for local use. Under normal operating conditions, during peak travel demand periods, the inside number 1 lane will be used or designated freight only. Currently, there are about 70% of the trips on I-5 through the Redding urban area during peak hours are local trips, and separating those types of traffic during that time is highly beneficial.
Yeah.
In the future, lane management, the same technologies and infrastructure that are proposed may be used for high occupancy, transit, and zero emission vehicles through this corridor. To make managed lanes possible, auxiliary merge lanes need to be connected between State Route 44 and 273 interchanges for a short distance. And this component also remedies three collision clusters by addressing the primary collision factors, namely collisions as a result of merging, lane weave, and speed differential due to the many short successive entry and on-ramps and differences in elevation that are causing a lot of traffic to have to switch from lane to lane, and also to have very high differentials in speed between freight trucks and through traffic. Second, we'll be filling a gap in the region's active transportation trunk line network along the east side of I-5. Redding's major trip destinations are separated by I-5, yet there are only two high-quality east-west crossings of I-5 for 3 miles through central Redding for bicyclists and pedestrians. Proposed improvements will help residents, including numerous disadvantaged communities, access these crossings and the wide range of destinations that are located on the other side of I-5. Third, a freight vehicle charging station will be added at the Cottonwood Way Station. located at the confluence of the North State Interregional Freight Network, and prior to traversing the surrounding mountain ranges, this is the ideal spot for charging. In addition to these improvements, CERTA will be seeking a Caltrans Strategic Partnerships Program grant to plan additional improvements along the larger I-5 corridor to mitigate the impacts of I-5 closures, including additional truck parking and other strategies that can be implemented along the larger corridor between Sacramento and Redding. Total project cost is $79.6 million, with $4.5 million in regional STIP shares requested for the project. And CERTA and Caltrans District 2 are working together to aggressively pursue state and federal funds to fill the funding gap. And I thank you for your time and your consideration for this project.
Thank you so much. I wanted to ask you about the charging station and whether that is going to be EV and hydrogen, and if you could tell us a little bit more about that. I was also very impressed at your 3 points of focusing on how you're going to move vehicles, especially high occupancy vehicles, through the corridors. So if you could give a little bit more detail there.
Thank you. Yes, we're working on both. We're obviously the charging is the easier solution in terms of the infrastructure, but we've been working for quite some time on developing partnerships and the technical ability to have hydrogen charging at this location.
Great. Thank you so much. And wonderful presentation. I believe we don't have any public comment on this presentation. And commissioners, are there any other comments you have on the Shasta Regional Transportation Agency? If not, Teresa, I'm going to throw it back to you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, that concludes our presenters for the North hearing. And I'd like to thank you and the commissioners for your participation. This is a very important program to all our partners in the North, and we will have a repeat for our Southern partners on February 3rd at 1 o'clock, which is the South region, the South hearing of the STIP. So I thank you very much. If there are any follow-up questions that any of the commissioners have on any of the regions, please feel free to reach out to us and we will get you the information. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Bye.
Bye.